Welcome to the second part of the lecture, Introduction to Clutch. Today we'll see about the clutch operation, and we'll also see in details the various components of the clutch. So now we should see the clutch operation. This is how the various components are arranged, and we'll look at each component in detail a bit later. This is a very simple schematic. You can see that this is the clutch plate. The red one is the clutch plate. This is the flywheel. This is the pressure plate. This is a spring which is called as diaphragm spring. This is the real release bearing. This is the clutch housing. And this is the input gear shaft, the shaft which is leading to the transmission. And this one is the clutch fork. The clutch plate is mounted on the input gearbox shaft, which has splines here so that clutch plate can slide along its axis to and fro for engagement and disengagement. Now, typically what happens is when the clutch is engaged, the clutch plate is pressed against the flywheel with the pressure plate. So as the flywheel is rotating with the engine, so what's going to happen when the clutch plate is pushed against the flywheel by the pressure plate, after some initial slip, the clutch plate, the flywheel and the pressure plate will all rotate as one unit, right? And the energy is transmitted from the engine through the flywheel, through the clutch plate and through the input shaft of the gearbox to the transmission and further downstream in the powertrain. So that's how the energy transfer happens when the clutch plate is engaged. So now, when the clutch is disengaged, what happens? So we can immediately see that when the clutch is disengaged, or in other words, the clutch pedal is now pressed. So this is the release bearing and this is the clutch fork. So when the pedal is pressed, what happens is that there is a force which is applied by the release bearing on this diaphragm spring. We'll look at what it is shortly. There is a spring called diaphragm spring on the pressure plate. So when the force is applied in this direction by the release bearing, then the outer end of the diaphragm, this is the outer end of the diaphragm, the outer end of the diaphragm spring is moved in the opposite direction. Okay, so it moves the pressure plate assembly to the right. As you can see, the pressure plate assembly moves to the right. The force which holds the clutch plate against the flywheel is released. So we can immediately see that the contact between the clutch plate and the flywheel and the pressure plate is broken. So the link between the engine and the gearbox is also broken now. Okay, so that's what happens when the clutch plate is pressed or clutch is disengaged. Now as I release the clutch pedal, exact opposite sequence of operations take place. So what happens is, this force is released. So what happens is, this force is released and now the diaphragm spring will move like this, in this direction. It will push the pressure plate. So what happens is, this force is released and now the diaphragm spring will move in this direction. And it will push the pressure plate to the left. And then the clutch plate will be pushed against the flywheel. And the motion will be transmitted to the gearbox. We can see this. As the pedal is pressed, the diaphragm spring is pressed and the outer portion is moved in the right direction, so the clutch plate is disengaged or it is moved away. And similarly, when the pressure is released, again the diaphragm spring is moved in the opposite direction and the clutch plate is again engaged with the flywheel. So this is how, so that's what happens in the friction clutch. So these are various components, and this is how friction clutch works. So let's now look at each and every components, and we'll observe that how they contribute in the functioning of the friction clutch. First component that we'll see is the clutch plate. So as we look at the clutch plate, we immediately observe that there is a friction material on it. This here are called splines for mounting the clutch plate on the gearbox input shaft. The splines are like projections on the inner surface, as you can see here, so that the clutch plate can slide on the corresponding splines of the input shaft to the gearbox, so that any rotations of the clutch plate is transmitted to the gearbox input shaft. We can see that this central hub of the clutch plate has splines arrangement. You can also observe that the friction material is riveted on the clutch plate. So the friction material enables the pickup of the torque from the flywheels when the clutch is engaged. We can also see these coil springs which are mounted here along the circle. So these coil springs are mounted in the cavities. You can see these here, there are some cavities in the core of the plate, and their main function is to ensure that they reduce the torsional vibrations so that they act as a torsional springs. So when the clutch is immediately engaged, now as the clutch plate is between the flywheel and the pressure plate, so what happens is that the pressure plate pushes the clutch plate against the flywheel. So let's say the clutch plate is at rest and flywheel is rotating at some non-zero speed. So suddenly there is a torque that is transmitted, right? And there is a speed differential, so there can be some judger due to sudden pickup of the torque. So these coils reduce the torsional vibration which result due to the sudden engagement between the clutch plate and the flywheel. So that's the role of coil springs. So similar mechanism is provided along the axis. So if you look at the section of the clutch plate, you can see that the central plate of the clutch plate, when it goes to the friction material, this is the central plate of the clutch plate, when it goes to the friction material, has a shape like this. It is a thin plate, but it is pressed like this to cushion any sudden load that comes along the axial direction or along the axis when the clutch plate is pressed between the flywheel and the pressure plate. There is also going to be a force along the axial direction. Okay, so it is done suddenly, then there can be shocks and vibrations along the axis. So to reduce and absorb these forces, we have these cushion springs. These are the cushion springs. So we look at this construction, we can see that this material is like blade of a fan. So this comes out from the hub, we can see here. So these are the blades that we are talking about. This is coming out from the hub. So this is like this. So these are the blades which are coming out from the hub. These arms are attached to the central hub of the clutch plate. So these plate, which essentially projects from the hub, and they are depressed like this, only a small depression, so that the force get cushioned. So this is about the clutch plate. Next we see pressure plate. So this is a pressure plate assembly with so called diaphragm spring. These diaphragm spring has these fingers. These are the fingers, and these fingers are pivoted at this fiber train. These diaphragm spring have circular rings on both the sides, so that circular ring acts as the pivoted point. So what happens is that when we depress the clutch pedal, we are actually applying force on this central part of this structure through the release bearing. So when we apply a force which essentially acts on this, so these fingers act like a pivot here. And so when we apply force, what happens to this other end? It is going to be pulled up. But this end is connected to the pressure plate. So the pressure plate also moves up in this direction, the opposite direction of the applied force. So when the diaphragm spring is pressed in this way, the pressure plate is moved away from the clutch plate by the spring action of the fingers. And when the force is released, the motion happens in the opposite direction. So the diaphragm spring is used to engage and disengage the clutch. And the actuation of the diaphragm spring takes place through the release bearing. This is the pressure plate assembly. The force is applied at the center by the release bearing. And you can see this is the shape of the fingers. So when we are pressing this in the downward direction or in this direction, then this part or the other end of the spring is pulled up. So this is causing the disengagement. So this is how the actuation takes place. This actuation mechanism can be mechanical also with the use of wires and links, and it can be hydraulic also as shown here. So when we press the clutch pedal with the help of the master cylinder and the slave cylinder, and with the help of this hydraulic fluid which is flowing here, this clutch fork is activated, and accordingly the clutch assembly is getting engaged and disengaged. This hydraulic arrangement is basically multiplying the driver's effort. Finally, what is the torque transmitted by the clutch? So the torque transmitted by the clutch at steady state is given by TC, that is the torque transmitted, is equal to mu into F axial into RM into N, where mu is the clutch lining friction coefficient. It is generally 0.3 to 0.45 for organic friction lining, and F axial is the axial force applied on the clutch plate. RM is the average radius on which the axial force is applied, and N is the number of friction surfaces. Like in case of single clutch plate, the number of surfaces will be 2, and likewise for the multi-plate clutch. So this is all about the introduction of the clutch. Next, in the next lecture, we'll see the derivation of the various equations, the uniform wear theory and the uniform pressure theory. So thank you.